coupled equations. So today I will just take another example, something which is again probably familiar. So something called the Fibonacci sequence. It's a sequence of numbers, right? Have people seen the definition before? How is it? How is this defined? What are the first few terms of this? Right. Okay, great. So usually, so often we put two ones. So I mean, sometimes you'll also see it without this one. So it's 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, and so on. So this sequence is called the Fibonacci sequence, and so let's just number these terms. So this leading one, which is, you know, sort of an extra thing you put at the end. So let's call this F0. That's the first term. So let me say F0 is 1, the zeroth term. F1 is 1. And how do you generate the remaining terms? As a sum of the two preceding ones, right? So F of n plus 1 is F of, or maybe I should write F of n plus 2. So f of n plus 2 is f of n plus 1 plus f of n for all n at least 0. So I'm looking at this as a sequence, and clearly this is the key. This is the key thing. It's called the recurrence relation. It tells us how to get the next term once you know the preceding terms. Now the question is, you know, and this is just one of a family of, you know, several sequences which you can generate like this. You can pretty much take any rule you want. You can say Fn plus 2 is, I don't know, 2 times Fn plus 1 plus some 5 times Fn, or you can also involve 3 preceding terms, 4 preceding terms. So lots of possibilities are there. So these are all called recurrence relations. Now the question is this. So let's only look at Fibonacci. Can one write a formula for the nth term? So the question is this. Can you actually say what Fn is? So I just want to know what the nth term is. So if I tell you, you know, F 100, so what is the 100th term? So of course, one answer is you can go through the sequence. You can start from 1 and keep going all the way to 100 to find out what the 100th term is. Right? That you can always do, because next term is just obtained by adding the two preceding ones. You keep doing that till you reach the 100th term. But if I increase, say, 1000, 10,000th term and so on, then that becomes very impractical. Right? So the question is, if I give you n, you should only use that n, the value of n itself, and immediately find the answer, rather than having to start from the first term and go till the nth one. Okay, so that's what I mean by a formula for the nth term. Okay, so has anybody seen this before? Formula for the nth term of Fibonacci. Okay, great. So let's see how, you know, matrices or eigenvectors and so on will help us solve this problem. It's again a very very nice application of these things. So let's try and bring a matrix into the picture. Okay. So the key thing is again this. So let's do the following. Like we did yesterday, let's define a vector x. It's two column vector of size 2, whose two entries are fn and fn plus 1. Okay. So the two entries which are used to compute the next one. So I'll put them in the form of a column vector. And since it depends on n, I will give this a name. I will call it xn, okay, for n greater than or equal to 0. Let's define xn like this. So for example, you can see how the sequence of vectors looks like. X0 is 1, 1. X1 is 1, 2. The next one is 2, 3, 3, 5, 5, 8, 8, 13, and so on. Just 2, 2 at a time. Okay, so now let's let's again ask the following question. Since I have a rule which tells me how to get the next fn from the preceding fn's, let's find a rule that tells you how to get the next xn from the preceding xn's. Okay, so in particular, suppose I look at, let me call it xn plus 1. So what would xn plus 1 look like? It is fn plus 1, fn plus 2. Right, it's the next xn. How is this related to the previous one? How, what is this, what's the relation between xn plus 1 and xn? So let me write this down properly as a question. What's the relation between xn plus 1 and xn? How can I obtain xn plus 1 from xn? So let's also write out xn.
Xn minus
1. Xn.
More than 2 matrix.
It is a?
Where we had fn plus 2 is fn plus 1 plus fn. There's 2 terms.
Correct.
I think here we need one more.
You need one more. Why do you say that? Because, no, okay, so think of it like this, xn itself is what, fn and fn plus 1, right? It has fn and fn plus 1. So, okay, so let's do the following. So let's write out xn plus 1 first on one side. It's a column vector, fn plus 1, n plus 2, and on the other side I have the other column vector, which is xn. I claim I can actually find a 2 cross 2 matrix such that when I multiply this by this, I will get that vector.
Yes,
that you can do? 0, 1? Okay, so observe, if you allow for matrices, then you can get a matrix like this, a 2 cross 2 matrix which will convert xn plus 1, I mean which will relate xn plus 1 and xn. Okay, so let's call this matrix as A. So observe, why did we get this? 0 into 1 fn, fn plus 1 is just fn plus 1, and fn plus 2 is fn plus fn plus 1. So we have just used the given data to construct this. Okay. Okay, so what is the advantage of having done it this way? This is also a recurrence relation. What is it doing? It is relating the n plus 1th term to the nth term, right? In what way is it better than the previous recurrence? The previous recurrence relates the n plus 1th term, or rather the n plus 2th term, to 2 preceding terms, right? The n plus 2th fellow is only given as something involving 2 preceding terms. Here it is just in terms of 1 preceding term. Okay, so in a sense you have brought down the complexity of the recurrence. It has become a simpler recurrence relation. Here, for example, instead of a Fibonacci recurrence like this, if I define another sequence a naught, say, let's say I tell you a1 is 1, let's say the starting term, and suppose I tell you an plus 1 is 2 times an for n greater than or equal to 1. So here's another example of a recurrence of a recurrent sequence. Okay, it's a different recurrence because the n plus 1th term is known, is given only in terms of the nth term. Okay, here if I ask you what is the nth term of this sequence, okay, let's see the first few terms. First term is 1. What's the second term? Absolutely, it's just 2 power n, right? All you're doing is just multiplying the previous term by a 2, therefore it's just 2 power n. So it's a much simpler thing to solve. You can tell the nth term immediately. If it involves 2 previous terms, it's more complicated. So this matrix, what it's cleverly doing is converting this recurrence using 2 terms into a just a 1 term recurrence. It's xn plus 1 has just become some matrix times xn. Okay, so the trade-off is you have to now deal with a matrix and a column vector instead of just numbers. But you know, so what is the beauty of this? We have managed to do the following: xn plus 1, just like the example that I just gave you, a power n x 1, right? I keep doing this again and again. A xn will be a times a xn minus 1 and so on, right? I keep doing this till I will, let's see what we get. A xn, so total, this is power is 1, this is n, n plus 1 is n plus 1, so this is a to the n x 1, this is correct. Okay, it's a to the n times x 1, and further let me go one more step, let's write it as a n plus 1 x naught. And what is x naught? X naught is what is xn? Xn is fn fn plus 1. X naught in this case, remember, is f0 f1, so it is 1 1, right? I wrote it out. This is x naught. So the answer here is, how do you compute xn plus 1, the vector? It is just given by n, a to the n plus 1 times this column vector. Okay, so this is at least a partial solution to the question. So therefore, what do we know? How do you compute? This is what xn plus 1. So the final answer is this: xn plus 1 is therefore the matrix A raised to the n plus 1 times the vector 1 1. Or, you know, since it's true for all n, I might as well only, or equivalently, let me just write it as xn is a power n 1 1. And what is xn? Xn has what we want. Remember, I asked for a formula for the Fibonacci number fn, and that fn is sitting here as the first component. So how, you know, what's the final answer? If I want fn, what I must do is I must calculate the nth power of this matrix. I should multiply it by 1 1 and take the first component. First component will be exactly fn. Okay, so that's an in principle solution to my problem. So therefore, fn is therefore, what is this? It's just the first component of the column vector a to the n multiplied by 1 1. Okay, so that is the answer, except it's only an in principle answer, because of course we don't quite know what the final formula is. I asked for a formula in terms of n. This is some kind of formula, but it involves, to make it more explicit, we need to figure out how to calculate the nth power of this matrix. Okay, see, nth power of a number is easy. There I had to just do 2 power n, that was easy. But if I have a matrix, calculating the nth power is no longer easy, right? Is this fine? So the question is, how do I compute the nth power of this matrix? Cayley Hamilton theorem. Okay. So the solution that will be easy to do is diagonalizing. Okay, this is where eigenvalues, eigenvectors come in. So let's see, if you can diagonalize this matrix, why is it easy to calculate nth powers? So let's see, suppose I can diagonalize the matrix, let's diagonalize A. What do we mean by that? You calculate eigenvalues, eigenvectors, right? Let's do it, it's rather easy. 0, 1, 1, 0, what's the determinant of A minus lambda I? That's the determinant, 0, so that means minus lambda into this, lambda into lambda minus 1, minus 1 is 0, lambda square minus lambda minus 1 is 0. Okay, that's my characteristic equation, and I have to solve it. What are the roots? What are the roots of this equation? Yeah, it's not two easy roots. You have to use the quadratic formula, right? It's 1 plus or minus root 5 by 2. Okay, just use the quadratic b square minus 4ac kind of thing. So that's your, those are the two values, the eigenvalues. And corresponding to these, you will find two eigenvectors. Okay, now let's not even worry about finding the eigenvectors. Let's just call them something. So in other words, so let say you have two eigenvectors. I don't know what to call them, x1, x2, and y1, y2 be the eigenvectors. So as usual, like we did yesterday, we will form the matrix P, which consists of these eigenvectors, x1, x2 in the first column, y1, y2 in the second column. This is the matrix of eigenvectors. So you'll see in a minute, I mean, it's easy to calculate these numbers if you really want to. So for example, I can tell you what they are in this example. It seems to be, so let's give these two roots a name. Let's call alpha as 1 plus root 5 by 2. So let's call alpha and beta as 1 minus root 5 by 2. Then this matrix P is, in fact, 1 alpha, 1 by beta, 1. Okay, so if you really want it, you can do this. But you will see in a minute, it's actually not required to know what these exact numbers are. Okay, so what did diagonalization mean? It said you can write the matrix A as PD P inverse. So where D is of course the matrix of eigenvalues. Right? That's the key thing that diagonalization gives us. And so why is this useful to compute higher powers of A? If I compute A square, for example, it's just A into A. And this is identity. Right? So the PP inverse in the middle goes away, it becomes PD square P inverse. Right? More generally, you do it once more. You do A cube means you must multiply this by another PD P inverse. Again, the P inverse P will get eaten up in the middle, you will get PD cubed P inverse. So in general, A power n becomes PP inverse is the same. You just have to raise D to the power n. Right? So that is the key advantage of being able to diagonalize a matrix. Okay, so now let us see, why does this help us to solve that problem? Now what does this look like? D power n we know, this is P okay, so D power n is easy to calculate, so we know what it is. So now we are ready to solve the original question. What is the nth, A power n times 1, 1 is what we should calculate. So let's use this to calculate A power n times 1, 1. This is P alpha power n beta power n P inverse 1, 1. Okay. Again, P inverse, if you want, you can write it out explicitly, but it is some matrix with four numbers in it, right? So in a sense, I'm going to worry about what is the dependence on n. Then the constants that I get, I don't need to worry about right now. So what is this? So P inverse times 1, 1. P inverse is some matrix, some A, B, C, D, four entries are there. You multiply it by 1, 1, you will get some column vector. Okay, so I don't know, let's call it PQ. I don't care what it is right now. Some two numbers P and Q. Now I multiply that by alpha to the n, beta to the n. So what does that become? Alpha to the n times P, beta to the n times Q. Okay. Further, I have to multiply it by this matrix P, which is again some matrix with 4 entries in it, right? Some A, B, C, D. So if I multiply that matrix with this guy, what will my entries look like? This first entry will look like some multiple of alpha power n plus some other multiple of beta power n, right? So let's call it some A alpha power n plus some B beta power n. The bottom will look like some C alpha power n plus D beta power n. For some A, B, C, D, some real numbers, let's say A, B, C, D. So the final answer is the Fibonacci number Fn is the first component of A power n times 1, 1, right? That was our answer here. So what is Fn? It is just A alpha power n plus B beta power n. So using this, so Fn, we conclude, must have the following form. It must be of the form A alpha n plus B beta n for some numbers alpha A and B, okay, for all n. Question is, what are A and B, right? Again, one of two things: you can go back and do the exact calculation of P and P inverse, right, and then you will get A and B directly, or it's much simpler to just find out A and B by substituting some values of n, okay. So here's a simpler way of calculating A and B. Let's put n equal to 0. So I'll say to find A and B, let's put n equal to 0. So f0 is 1 in that case, but what will it become here? It's A plus B, right? Because I put n equal to 0, so this is just 1 and 1. Now if you put n equal to 1, again f1 is 1, but this formula becomes A alpha plus B beta. Okay, so A and B are two numbers which satisfy these two equations. A plus B is 1, A alpha plus B beta is 1. Okay, from these two equations, let's solve for A and B. So what does, therefore, what is A? So how should we do this? Let's say, let's multiply the first equation by alpha and subtract. So from that I can compute beta. So what will I get? 1 minus, so I'm going to multiply this by alpha. Alpha minus 1 is B times alpha minus beta, right? So B is alpha minus 1 by alpha minus beta. Okay, similarly A is, let's multiply this by beta and subtract. So it becomes beta minus 1 by beta minus alpha. Right? So this just means I don't have to go back and really use the exact form of P. I can find out the constants afterwards by plugging in these values. Now what are alpha, you know, what are these numbers? They're actually simpler than they look. So alpha is 1 plus root 5 by 2. So what is alpha minus beta? Well, I mean, what is the denominator? What is alpha minus beta? Root 5. Okay, what is alpha minus 1? Root 5 minus 1 by 2. So this is root 5 minus 1 by 2 root 5. This is beta minus 1 would be minus root 5 minus 1 by minus root 5, sorry, 2 root 5, right? So it's root 5 plus 1 by 2 root 5. Okay, so okay, I guess that's trying to see if I can actually write in a cleaner way, but maybe not. So therefore, here's the final answer. What's the nth Fibonacci number? It is equal to A is 1 plus root 5 by 2 root 5. So I'll pull out a 1 by 2 root 5 common. It's 1 plus root 5 times alpha power n plus, I'm sorry, what? Alpha minus beta, yeah. Correct. No, but this 2 is coming from the top. It's coming from alpha minus 1. Right? Alpha minus 1 is root 5 minus 1 by 2, no? Right? So it's coming from the top. And this is beta minus alpha, so the sign is the other way around. So okay, so it's this minus, because it's root 5, oh, plus b, right? Okay, sorry, plus root 5 minus 1. So this is root 5 plus 1, so let's make it that. Okay. So here's the formula for the nth Fibonacci number. It is 1 by 2 root 5 times root 5 plus 1 into alpha power n plus root 5 minus 1 into beta power n, where alpha and beta are those numbers, 1 plus root 5 by 2, 1 minus root 5 by 2, right? So sort of a priori, before you actually began this process, you could never have imagined that you will get such a formula for the nth Fibonacci number, because you know it seems to involve some root 5s, whereas it's all some nice integers, right? So that in itself is a very remarkable fact. It says this final answer is always some natural number. So if you take the nth power of 1 plus root 5 by 2, multiply it by this, you add it to this and divide by 2 root 5, the answer is an integer, okay? And that integer is exactly the nth Fibonacci. Okay, so here's a formula for the nth Fibonacci number. And this method by itself works in general. You can do it more generally for other two-term recurrences, even if you had, say instead of these fn plus 1 is, you know, fn plus fn minus 1, if it were other numbers, 2 times fn plus 3 times fn plus 1, that's also okay. So similarly, if you have other kinds of equations, you will just end up with the roots of that quadratic equation, that's all. It will become some other alpha and beta, not 1 plus root 5 by 2 and 1 minus root 5 by 2. Okay, so any questions on? So this is actually another application of you know, diagonalizability, or rather of finding eigenvalues. It helps you solve recurrence relations like these. And in fact, there's also a similar version of this for ODEs themselves, which I won't talk too much about, but you know, maybe you can try this as a nice exercise. So I'm sure people have seen this kind of equation, d square y by dx square equals for example, if you have to solve. So I'm just going to make the point that this is actually a lot like the Fibonacci sequence. If you have to solve for y, solve this differential equation, d square y by dx square is dy dx plus y, right? So how does one solve an equation like this? So you'd usually put everything on one side. Think of it as y double dash minus y dash minus y is 0. And then auxiliary equation, right? You will find the roots of that quadratic polynomial and so on. Now, an analogous way of thinking about this is similar. Instead of maybe I'll call my variable as t so that I can use x for my vector. So you define capital X to be the vector consisting of two components. First component is the function y, the second component is its derivative. Okay. Now, what is the derivative of this vector? So remember, we did derivatives of vectors yesterday. If I take derivative of x, this is dy dt, this is d square y dt square. Right? How is this related to x? I claim that the derivative of x dx dt is actually 0 1 1 0 1 1 times y dy dt. Okay? So why don't we just see this? Instead of x, I'm going to put y dy dt. So observe here, if I do dy dt, I'll get 0, 1 dy dt. Second component is d square y dt square is y plus dy dt. That's the given equation. right? So solving the, if y satisfies this equation, then this vector y dy dt satisfies this equation, okay? And what is this equation? Dx dt is ax. Where A is the same matrix that we just now wrote down, and X is this column vector. Okay, so observe again, it's done the same thing that we had yesterday. It has now made the differential equation much simpler, because it is just derivative equals a multiple of the original function. But the only the extra complication it has introduced is the fact that it's now a matrix rather than a number. If it were a number, we know the answer. It's just e power a t. But it's now a matrix, and so I sort of made this point yesterday, which I believe Professor Sundar also talked about today, is you can actually define the exponential also for a matrix. So in fact, this implies x is up to a constant really the exponential of the matrix A multiplied by t, okay? So where this really means that infinite series and so on, okay? And if you really write this out, you get back the same thing, that it is the solution that you get using the auxiliary equation and so on. So this is sort of what lies behind that method of auxiliary equation. You make it into, as soon as you make this into a vector, the equation becomes simpler, allowing you to actually solve it explicitly. So this is sort of the differential equation version of the Fibonacci sequence. Any questions on? Okay, so what I want to do is now talk about one other context in which one sees matrices, and specifically where an eigenvector of that matrix is interesting. So suppose I have, so this is really in the realm of probability. So what am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about a very simple probabilistic model, and there is a natural matrix associated with this model. So imagine I have maybe 4 points numbered 1, 2, 3 and 4 on the plane. And so there is some object sort of hopping around from place to place. So initially the object is say at point 1 at time t equal to 0. Now what the object does at every point of time is to jump to one of the other vertices, okay? So at every point of time it jumps, so it can jump, it can go from 1 to 2, it can jump to 3, or it can jump to 4, and or it can stay where it is, or let's say it can just remain at 1 itself. There are 4 choices at every given time. Now each of these occurs with a certain probability, okay? Let's say there's a probability half that it will stay there, and maybe, you know, I don't know, 1/6 or some 1/4 something, you know, it should all add up to 1, of course, that's important. Total probability should be 1, okay? So let us say there are some probabilities. So let me give this probability some name. Let us say Pij is probability of jumping from I to J. From the vertex labeled I to the vertex labeled J. So for example, the probability that it will remain at 1, meaning it will jump from 1 to 1, is what we'll call P11. This will have probability P12, P13, and P14. Okay? So then the object, let's say, has jumped to some other vertex, say it's at 2, then at the next point of time, again the same question. It can jump to any of the 4 fellows. It will either remain, it will jump back, meaning it remains at 2, or it can jump to 1, 3 or 4, okay? So at every instant of time, there is some probability that from 2 it can jump to something else. So it can either come back, okay? So you get the idea. For every vertex, if the object is at that vertex at some point of time, there is some probability with which it will jump to any one of the other vertices or remain where it is. All these things have probabilities. Okay, so let's say that is our model. That's the system that we are considering. So now associated to such system is clearly the set of probabilities. So we can form a matrix. We can form a 4x4 matrix whose entries are these numbers. So P11, P12. Sorry, 2122. And so on. P44. Okay, so I form the probability matrix which has these as the entries. Okay, now, so firstly, here's the question: what do I know about the row sums of this matrix? If I add up any row, 1, because that's the sum of all the probabilities, right? So from, if I add the first row, it will tell you what is the sum of the probabilities that I can jump from 1 to any of the other vertices. That's 1. So all these row sums are 1. That is an important point here. Row sums are 1. All row sums are 1. And I claim, in fact, that makes it easy to see that 1 is an eigenvalue of this matrix. So I claim if a matrix has all row sums equal to 1, then 1 is an eigenvalue of this matrix. Has anyone seen this fact before? Okay, it's very easy to prove. Let's find the eigenvector. Can you find an eigenvector for the eigenvalue 1? Meaning I want you to find a vector x such that px equal to x. Find a non-zero vector, of course. Row sums are 1. That's the key thing I want you to use. Take 1, 1, 1, 1, right? So for example, here, I take p. I take 1, 1, 1, 1. What will I get? This into 1, this into 1, this into 1, this into 1 just means it's giving me the row sum of the first row. That's a 1, right? Similarly, row sum, second row is 1, third row is 1, fourth row is 1. Okay? So if the row sums are all 1, then 1, 1, 1, 1 is always an eigenvector of that matrix. Therefore, 1 is an eigenvalue. For the eigenvalue, 1. It px is 1 times x. Okay, so that's an interesting fact to keep in mind about such matrices. Now, okay, so now the other thing one does, so this is only the jumping part. I'm only telling you with what probabilities can it jump to the various places. But let's imagine the system at time t equal to 0, at the very first instant of time. Okay, so I have my object. I have to place that object on some starting vertex, right? At the starting point, where is my object? That's a question which we have to know. That's the initial condition. So that again, I tell you, is given by some probabilities, meaning at time t equal to 0, I will place the object on vertex 1 with some probability, or in vertex 2 with some other probability, or it could be in 3 or it could be in 4. For each of them, there is some probability. Okay? So let's call these the starting probabilities. So starting probabilities or initial condition, starting probability. So let probability that the object is at I at time t equal to 0 be some number si. Okay, SIs are the initial probabilities, S1, S2, S3, S4. What is the sum of the SIs? 1 again, right? Because it must be 1. It's the total probability. So observe, probability of being in S1 initially or in 2 initially or 3 initially or 4 initially. This sum is a 1. Okay, so I give you some SIs. Okay. So here's the next question. This is the probability that I am at I at time 0. What is the probability that the object is at I at time t equal to 1? After one jump, what's the probability that the object is at position I? Okay, let me ask that question. So find probability that object is at vertex I at time t equal to 1 after doing one jump. No, what do you mean by conditional probability? You could have placed it anywhere. Okay, so you must sum over all possibilities. Now what he's saying is absolutely right, but except you must also sum over all possibilities. So let's just do it, right? So suppose you placed it at 1 at time t equal to 0 and then it jumped to I, or you placed it at 2 and it jumped to I, 3 and jumped to I, and so on, right? So what is it? What is the probability of having placed it at 1? It is S1. Okay, and we assume these are independent events. The jumping probability is independent of, you know, these initial probabilities. So it's S1 multiplied by P1i, S2 times P2i, and so on. Okay, so this is the what you get after one jump. Now, does this look like something you can express in terms of matrix multiplication? I have 4 numbers S1, S2, S3, S4, and I am multiplying them by the elements of my matrix. So imagine I did the following. I put a row vector with my starting probabilities, and suppose I put my matrix P here. Okay, P1i means what? Ith column, right? I take the ith column of this matrix. I do S1 into first guy plus S2 into the second, S3 into third, S4 into fourth, right? So when I multiply row vector with P, the answer is again a row vector, some 4 entries, right? And what you are calculating is the ith entry here. You want the probability of being at position 3, you must take the third entry of the answer. Okay, so this is the initial vector of probabilities. This is the probabilities that you will get after one jump, right? It's just this vector S multiplied by P. It's just multiplication. Okay, is this fine? This is the sort of key thing to keep in mind. Now what happens after two jumps? So this is where you are after one jump. So let's give these probabilities a name, these vectors. So let me call this vector, should I call it S again? Maybe not. So let's call this T maybe. So let's say T0 is the vector of starting probabilities, S1, S2, S3, S4. These are the probabilities at time t equal to 0. Now what are the probabilities of being at each vertex at time t equal to 1? It is T1. Which is, as we just said, it's T naught times P. So these are basically probabilities of being at each vertex at time t equal to 1 after one jump. Now, what's the vector of probabilities at time t equal to 2? what? Absolutely, right? So how can you land up in position I? You start at 1, then you jump to some I, and then to some j, and from there you jump to I, right? You must do 2-step jump. Or equivalently, since we know the previous answer, after 1 step you know the probabilities, right? So let's say after 1 step you are in some vertex, from there you jump to I, correct? So if you do this, essentially what it amounts to is just multiplying the previous thing by a p each time. It's t1p or basically t0p square, okay, and so on. So you can see what's going on. If I want to know probability after n steps, it is just t0 multiplied by p power n. Okay, so this is the reason why this matrix p is very important. Sort of in higher powers of p, tell you, they capture what happens for several jumps. If you have multiple jumps, how do you capture the probability of the resulting event? Even though it looks very complex, it's just simply captured by taking a power of the matrix P. Okay, so this is a very, very important statement overall, that the nth probability is same as the original probability multiplied by P power. Okay, now so typically in a real life kind of system, so where the number of vertices is very large and you keep doing these possible jumps and so on, in a sufficiently complex system, what do you expect as time goes to infinity? Okay, what do you think will happen to this set of vectors? There's some probability of being at each one of the, say there are 1 million vertices. Okay, and in the next step, from each of these 1 million, you could have jumped to any of the other fellows, right? And you sort of hope, or you want to look for situations where the probability just remains the same, right? It's there's some kind of stability which sets in at sufficiently large time, meaning because there are so many complicated events possible, the net probability remains the same. If the probability of being in node 1 at say time 1 million is say a half, and the 1 million then 1 step again, it remains a half, because even though from 1 you could have moved to other places, you can also come back to 1 from other nodes, right? So this of course is not a rigorous statement, it's sort of more like an expectation that you'd like to have such things, and those are called stationary distributions. So this starting point, so we will say that t0 is stationary, is a stationary distribution for p if, or not t0 necessarily, t if you do it one more step, from t you jump one more step, these are the new probabilities that you will get, t into p, that remains the same as the original probabilities. Maybe I should call it, let's call it x. X is the vector in this example consisting of 4 fellows. Okay, so when you have such probabilistic models, this stationary distribution is often a very important thing to look at. So we want to know, does there exist a stationary distribution? And if so, what does it convey? It often contains some interesting information. Now, what does this equation remind you of? Xp is x. X is however a row vector. So I have a row vector x, I'm multiplying by the matrix p, and I want to get back the same vector. This is almost like the eigenvector equation, right? Except it's just for row vectors instead of column vectors. So how do I convert this to a column vector equation? Take transpose. Right, so let's do transpose on the whole equation. It says p transpose x, x transpose is x transpose, but x transpose is now a column vector, right? So what would that, what does that equation now mean? What is x transpose? What is X transpose for P transpose? It's a eigenvector, right? Let's call this Z. So it's P transpose Z is Z, which means Z is actually an eigenvector of P transpose. For the eigenvalue 1, okay. So I started out by saying P has an eigenvector for eigenvalue 1. That is the easy one. 1 1 1 1 1 is the eigenvector with eigenvalue 1 for P, okay. But actually, the interesting case, the so-called stationary distribution, is an eigenvector for P transpose. Okay, for the transposed matrix corresponding to the eigenvalue 1. Okay, so is this last thing clear? If I am looking for a vector such that the probability will not change after one jump, it will be a stationary probability. It will not change no matter how many jumps I do. The net probabilities of the various nodes will sort of even out. They will be the same as the starting probabilities. So this is what this amounts to, is to find the eigenvector of P transpose corresponding to the eigenvalue 1. Okay, this is fine. Now, so the reason why I wanted to talk about this example per se is because, in a sense, this is how search engines work these days, at least. So for example, this is how Google works. Okay, so what do they really do? Why you know, what does it amount to doing? So if you imagine that there are several web pages, so here's how they model it, for example. So you imagine the entire web, there are so many different websites, okay. You think of each website as being one vertex. So the set of all websites can, you know, what does one do in order to jump to another website? Well, you follow a link on this website. Right? Often you click on a link that exists on this website, which will take you to another website. Right? So that is how you jump from websites to other websites. So with what probability do you jump from one to the other? So that's something that we must ask. So suppose I say you are on some website, and let us say there are 10 links in that website. Okay? So let's sort of make the approximation or assumption that you will jump to any one of those 10 with equal probability. If there are 10 links, let's say you click on any one of those at random, which means you will jump with probability 1/10. Okay, so from a given website, say if there are 10 links from that website, so let's say in my example 1, 2, 3, suppose from this website there are 5 links, I will assign probability 1/5 to each of these arrows. You will say that you will jump to any one of these other guys with probability 1/5, okay, and you keep doing that every website. From every website you see how many total links, and you say you follow each link with probability 1/ the total number of links, okay, uniform probability. So you set up a model of the web in this way, and so then what is so, and then you look for a stationary distribution of that system, okay, meaning you look for an eigenvector of P transpose. So you will get a matrix P in this way, and you look for an eigenvector of P transpose. That will tell you what to each website you will essentially assign a probability, right? There were 4 points, and to each point there was a certain probability assigned, which told you what is the probability of actually being at that website in the first place. So if you find a stationary distribution, what it will end up doing is to each website it will assign a probability. You will end up assigning a number to each website, a number between 0 and 1. Okay, let's call it S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S6, and so on. coming from the stationary distribution. Now, these numbers that you calculate in this way are what Google, for example, calls the page rank of that website. Okay, each website is assigned this number SI. You calculate this eigenvector and you see what that corresponding number is. So that's called the page rank of that website, and it is treated as a measure of the importance of that website. Okay, more important, or in your search results, the websites, you know, the first page of search results, the ones that are at the top of the search results. They are the ones which correspond to more important websites, websites which have a higher value of this stationary probability. Okay, and so essentially this, of course, this is, you know, what I said is somewhat simplified. There are some technical issues that need to be taken care of, but in essence this is the idea. What you do is you model the web in this way and you compute the stationary distribution, you compute this eigenvector, and once you compute this eigenvector, it produces a row vector for you with probabilities, and you think of those probabilities as being a measure of the importance of the various websites. And if you are given a search query, you pull up those websites which match the search query, which have higher importance. Okay, you list them in descending order of importance. And you know, empirically it seems from, you know, Google all these years that that's actually a very good measure of what's relevant or what's important and so on. Okay, anyway, I'll stop there.